Hello, Malty, masterly moving men's, and thank you to Johan Giesbers. I probably pronounced that wrong. My apologies, Johan. Anyway, you are providing the malt mention, Johan, for Ralfy Review 883, which is part of a significant short series on the value and usefulness of considering independent bottlings when we're buying Scotch whisky. I have a very good example here from Carn Mor independent bottlers, and it is a bottling of Glenturret, a Highland distillery, and it has a fairly distinctive personality, an old school style of malt. It's not generally sweet. It's naturally quite complex with a hint of phenolics about it, which isn't derived from peatiness. So it has a certain savoury dry aspect to its character. It is what you would call grassy, mild barley sugar, very soft, almost dry honey or manuka honey, and a sort of slight linseed savouriness. They call it Rue Mor, which is the independent presentation of Glenturret when you're buying it on the open market. This is matured in a hogshead. It's two casks which have been put together to provide 837 bottles. It was bottled in 2020, aged 8 years. Distilled in 2011, so we're getting a little bit of transparency there. When we come to the back label, there's not a lot of information. What they're basically saying is it's fresh hay bales wrapped in tobacco leaves with a long smoky finish. Approximately. But it's something to go on. The reason they provide these basic tasting notes is to give you some point of reference from their perspective. So I'm not decrying it. So long as tasting notes don't get too convoluted and abstract, which sometimes they do, depending on the bottler, they can get quite fanciful. And in doing so, they get quite distracting. So, any additional information? Yeah, bottled at 47.5%, and being a European bottling, it's 70 centilitres. If it was in the US market, it would be 75 centilitres. Why is that? Simple. Expediency and tradition. So I've poured a wee dram here. They don't say natural colour on the label, but you can see from the colour of that whisky, I can assure you that is natural colour, refreshingly light, and very telling actually, because it gives you some sort of indication as to the activity of the cask. Because when casks impart colour naturally, they do so in tandem with imparting the cask extract flavour into the whisky, which directly affects the speed and the nature of the maturation of the single malt. What I'm expecting from the information provided by the colour of the whisky and by the information given by the independent bottler is that I should get something, particularly at the age, 8 years old, I should get something that is young and spirit driven. And because it hasn't been double matured, cask finished, etc., you should get a good, honest representation of the singularity of this single malt, which is why I bought it, because that's what I'm looking for. I did review earlier this year a peated version, which I found a little bit homogeneous. It sort of worked, but it didn't quite appeal to me. And there were comments left that Other versions of official bottlings are really very good, so go and explore them. See what other reviewers have to say about them. Now, I'm going to come to the simple, practical cardboard packaging. This tells me something as well. The first thing it tells me is that being a simple cardboard box, they're not wasting a lot of money on over-presenting the whiskey, for which we then get charged, which ups the cost of what we're buying. What they're saying is single malt Scotch whiskey traditionally released at a higher strength and non-chill filtered. Good stuff. Over the last few decades, it has become popular to lower the alcohol strength for the whiskey and for the whiskey to be chill filtered so it did not turn cloudy with ice. I think that should be so it does not turn cloudy with ice. And this is a very good proactive statement. Anyway, to the malt itself. Wee stroly-poly around the glass, nothing shaky-shaky. Dry and creamy. It's got a creamy nose to it. Very clear, very fresh, very inviting. Immediately you nose this, you're getting the integrity of the presentation coming across loud and clear. If this whiskey was bottled at 40% chill filtered and with caramel added, it would be a very different experience. Not a slightly different experience, and I'm presenting my judgment to you about this because I've done a lot of exploration over the decades. It would be a fundamentally different delivery of the same single malt, but subdued and lessened. At a higher strength of 47 point, what was it? Just to remind us, 47.5%, being unchill filtered and evidently, although it's not declared, being natural colour, you're getting the integrity of presentation first appearing on the nose, and consequentially, and this happens every time, you get it in the palate as well when you're tasting it. There's some slightly gingery fruit notes and some fresh pear coming through in those nose as well. And a little bit of green and something slightly almondy, a gentle nuttiness which isn't immediately apparent because it's part of the dryness that comes through the character of Glenturret presented in this way. First taste, a reassuringly nippy arrival of something which is at a higher strength and visibly so. Higher strength, of course, automatically with more alcohol in the solution here, you simply have more flavors, naturally derived flavors, bound in a chemical physical relationship to the alcohol, and these are going to really be released at the moment that I add water. But just before I add some water to this, and I'm going to add a full teaspoonful because I'm not frightened about really diluting the whiskey, and it doesn't mean there's going to be less, because I've diluted it, there's going to be less flavour. It means that the flavour that's there is going to be released a little more quickly and in a little more concentration, which means the actual flavours will be more intense. Another taste. Just a tiny, tiny drop in the tongue. Slight sweet and sour, but there's a delicious, soft, savoury, almost oily linseed note, slightly marzipan. Hay is a good point of reference as they describe in the bottle. Tobacco, I'm really not getting so much in the way of tobacco leaves, unless you call it cigarette tobacco, light tobacco. But at this point, I'm going to add a teaspoon, 5 millilitres of water. What's happening now is you're getting the signs of vicimetry. Vicimetry, if I hold this close, you probably won't see it. Hang about, that's better. Get it in focus. But when you add water to your whiskey, hold it up with a light behind it and look at the swirling effect. This is vicimetry. It is when two liquids of a different density are suddenly put together. They don't immediately mix because of the weight, the molecular weight in each liquid. The water is lighter. The spirit ethanol is actually heavier because of the oils contained within it, which have not been chill filtered out. And it's the oils that add to the molecular weight of the ethanol, and you get that swirling effect, which subsides and settles down over time and is a precursor to a light presence of Scotch mist. We're not at the Scotch mist stage yet, but that will develop certainly if you add a bit more water than what I've already added. A minute in the glass for each year in the cask definitely applies once you've added some water. It knocks out the flavours, it livens up the event, and you'll notice it first and foremost after a few minutes when you go back to nosing the whiskey. And to get your bearings in this maltmates, I recommend that you pour a second glass 5 minutes after your first glass, after you've added water, and just leave it neat as a fresh pour, and go between the two and see for yourselves. This kind of presentation you really get strongly from independent bottlers, which is why they are one very good reason as to why they are worth looking out for. I know the availability is strongly determined by where you are in the world. So if you're in Canada, due to legalities and restrictions, because that's one of the reasons for the law, is to restrict things rather than to allow things. I'm just sharing with you, it's a fact of life. You will not find many independent bottlers, possibly Gordon MacPhail, perhaps a few signatory bottlings, and that'll be it. But certainly if you're in Holland or Germany and Scandinavia, you have far greater access to these, to the range and the diversity of independent bottlings. And really, Europe is the home of independent bottlings, where the market that has much more demand for these, what are characterized as authentic, singular styles of bottlings of Scotch whisky, which really work because Scotch whisky is malted barley. It's a delicate spirit. It just is. It's not like corn spirit or rye, which are dense, heavy spirits on distillation, which can really vary from official bottlings depending on the bottling strength, but it takes a lot longer, particularly with molasses rum, another good example, a lot longer in cask for that singularity to manifest itself. Taste. Fresh dry fruit, crispy apple, unripe banana. There's a nice little minty development in the actual development after the arrival. A little bit of green savoury notes, a natural savouriness which would get lost if this was an official bottling which had been put into a secondary maturation or finish, as the industry like to call it, particularly of Oloroso or PX sherry. That would probably start to get swamped. An intelligent warehouse person would probably season the sherry cask for about 6 months with new make spirit from this distillery, if it was an official bottling, to tone it down a bit so as to dovetail and mesh a much more sympathetic sherry cask finish onto an official bottling, because it's tempered the impact, the sudden heavy fresh impact of the cask. But many official bottlings don't do that because they're tapping into the market who are looking for the sherry bomb experience. And you'll get your sherry bomb, but a price. And the price is that you tend to get a diminished visibility of the singularness of the single malt, of the actual raw character of it. It always works better at a younger age. And as an eight-year-old, it's absolutely on point at this moment in time, because the hogshead has clearly been tempered. I suspect, actually, it's a fresh, rinsed bourbon hogshead rather than a sherry hogshead, because you're getting these gentler, softer, slightly vanilla notes, which don't encroach in any way on the personality and the character of the Glenturret. Very nicely done. Back to the taste. Sweetening up slightly, but not too much. Crispy note coming in to the development. Crisp apple, slightly sake note, a rice wine note, totally complementary, beautifully meshes in and very sympathetic to the character of the malt. And this is where the malt is really showing its natural complexity, which many malts from new distilleries don't really show, because unfortunately they tend to over distill. You only get this when you're pushing a little bit into the faints and getting that slight yeastiness, which tends to bring savouriness in to the development of the personality. But this is absolutely alive and kicking here. If you want to really get to know what the actual Glenturret signature is, clear, visible, this is a great bottling, a great style of bottling to go with. Back we go again to another taste, because I'm aware from experience that you just need to give it time, time and patience, which your average consumer does not have. And if they're going to put this into a tumbler with ice, they're not even going to notice it. They really aren't, unless you're in a particularly hot country where there comes the bliss point where the ice is melting and you've not added too much ice that's drowned the spirit, then you're going to be able to spot the identity. Here we go. I'm thoroughly enjoying myself here, actually. This is my third or fourth sip. I see where they're getting the tobacco reference from. That slight crisp, slightly acetic tobacco note is becoming more prominent in the development. There's a little bit of nuttiness in it. A touch of ginger in the background, soft green ginger, as in sushi ginger. Jasmine tea towards the finish. Light, crisp finish that lingers. It lingers because it has not been suppressed by any overt sweetness coming from the cask imposition. Partly because at this young age, the cask hasn't had time to do it. Very refreshing, very clean in the finish. Green notes, generalised green notes, savoury green notes, but a little bit sage, thyme, rosemary, those sort of green notes. And the mintiness subsides as it develops in the glass over time. Just a fascinating, savoury, old school style of single malt, which has been not fashionable for a while, but is now coming back into fashion, simply because people have personal experience being malt mates, the personal experience to know the value of it. What am I going to give this as a malt mark? It's a multi-mark time. It's a pretty good one. I'm going to give this 88 out of 100 as a malt mark. And sure, it isn't a 90 over 100 out of 100. So with any luck, fingers crossed, there's not going to be too much ralfy effect in this bottling. And the those that are looking and are guided by purely marks over 90 out of 100 will not be buying it. So that gives you a chance, hopefully, to find, if not this bottle, because bear in mind there's less than 1,000 bottles available. But let me reassure you, there'll be another bottling along shortly from either Carn Mor or another independent bottler, because Glenturret is clearly available out there from them. You know, it's been sold to the independent bottlers, and if they do as good a job as Carn Mor have done with this, it's a great showcase to set you up and to complement the official bottlings. And this is where the independent bottlers benefit the official bottlings. They endorse them. They endorse what they can be, and it's up to the official bottlers to present their liquor as it can be. Integrity bottlings. I would conclude by saying that I've made a kind of controversial statement recently where official bottlers dilute their single malts and chill filter the single malts and colour the single malts because they want to present them like they're blended whiskey, so as they don't stand out too much, so as they don't become too much of a competition. But I think it's too late for that. And I think that the educated customer is growing in influence on whiskey sales. And I think one good way of presenting and showcasing this influence is if you look at companies like Pernod Ricard and Diageo and Bacardi, who have strong, influential blended whiskey brands, they tend to be the companies that do most of the chill filtering, the dilution to 40%. Balvenie is another classic example. Glenfiddich brand. And Glenfiddich has their grants, so another good example of a big company that have strong blended whiskey brands which they want to protect. They want these to continue to dominate, and to a certain extent they will. But it's your smaller distillers, your smaller official distillers, who do not have, they just don't have these blended brands that are distributed internationally, like Springbank, like, for example, Distel, who have Bunahabhain, Deanston and Tobermory, like Glencadam, another great example. It's these official bottlings that don't have your prominent blended whiskey brands who are, in fact, to exert their influence and to respond to the demand for better single malts, better calibre of single malts on the market. They're the ones who are focusing, like Springbank, on integrity bottlings, unchill filtered, natural colour and bottled at a minimum of 46%. And there we have it. I'm Ralphie, thank you for watching. I will be back soon with 833 extras, and I'll be talking about developing your palate. And this is in response to a question from a malt mate. I'll see you soon.